erecting the security barrier around of the perimeter around that police station today. For the first time, we saw them move cement barriers farther out from the one block that they had previously. So they clearly are concerned that that was happening following the reports that they're the gang members, the Crips, the Bloods, and the black the black another African-American group had all gotten together and said that they were going to target police officers. This smoke down here, if you can see this, Wolf, is getting very, very heavy. It's not clear what's burning. I don't know if you guys have a helicopter shot up and can see what that is, but it seems to have picked up quite a bit in recent minutes, in just the last 5 or 6 minutes. And I don't even think they can get fire engines to these places right now because it's too dangerous. You go through those streets and it is a very, very hostile populace that you are greeted with. We came up Reisterstown Road a little while ago in the middle of many individuals who were carrying rocks, sticks, bricks, and everything else that they were. It was not a place where either police or fire department or any sort of public services would feel that they could operate freely. It sounds like in this area, just hearing from what police are saying here, that they may be moving some of these forces perhaps down to that area or to other areas where protesters are starting to splinter off. But it is going to be very difficult. Jamal Bryant saying that they are going to form a wall, a human wall, along Pennsylvania Avenue to try to contain the individuals coming out of West Baltimore toward downtown so that they can keep the violence of today from getting any worse. We're looking at the number of police officers. They are backing out now. Police are moving from this area. They'll probably leave some police officers here, but others, you can see them, some more heavily armed than others, and their gear more heavy than others. Those more heavily armored groups are going to start moving out. Wolf.
All right, stand by, because I want to just update for our viewers who may just be tuning in what's going on. A major American city, Baltimore, Maryland, at least a chunk of it now under attack by violent protesters, demonstrators. They have gone after police. At least seven police officers, we are now told, have been injured, some seriously, in these attacks. We know also some of the journalists have come under attack, including one D.C.-based photographer who works for us, was under attack, has been taken to a hospital. These protesters are angry because of the death of Freddie Gray, the 25-year-old individual who was arrested and died in police custody almost 2 weeks or so ago. You see looting that's been going on in this area. They've been going into a CVS pharmacy, just running in there and taking whatever they want out. It's happening right now. These are live pictures you're seeing coming in to us from our affiliates in Baltimore right now. Tom Fuentes is a former assistant director of the FBI. He's our CNN law enforcement analyst. Tom, I got to just say, I'm sure viewers who are watching here in the United States and around the world are asking a basic question. Where's the police force? Where's the National Guard? Why is this happening in the city of Baltimore? They had advertised hours ago that these protesters were going to take violent action, and I'm wondering what's going on.
Well, going back to Ferguson, Wolf, the police have been so criticized if they come out in force, if they come out wearing military gear, protecting themselves, helmets, and look mean, if they come out in armored cars. So Baltimore made a deliberate attempt here to keep that down, keep that militarization look down. And they were out there the other night in street shirts with no helmets, and I was criticizing that as being unsafe. So I think now they're finally realizing that when you have gangs on the streets threatening the police, the time for being nice and not putting on protective gear is over. It's time to protect not only yourself as a police officer, but the community. These are businesses. There are people in that community that need their personal property and their persons protected, and that's not happening.
And this could potentially get a whole lot worse. Stand by for a second, Tom. I want to bring in Captain Eric Kowalczyk. He's the spokesman for the Baltimore Police Department. Captain, what is going on in your city right now? It's hard to believe you're only 40 miles from the nation's capital, Washington, D.C., where we are.
Yeah, good afternoon, Wolf. So right now, Saturday we saw a group of protesters come out and peacefully voice their concern. There was a group of outside agitators in there. that caused acts of violence, and you saw some pretty remarkable restraint from our police officers. Right now, this is an entirely different situation. This is not protesters. This is lawless people with no regard for the safety of the community that they're in, that are engaging in these violent acts against our police officers and these very destructive acts against the community. Our officers are going to do everything that they can, not only to protect themselves, but the community, the businesses, the people that live in that area. You're going to see appropriate measures taken by the police department. We've already deployed gas. We may use other crowd control techniques in order to restore order into the area. We're sending in additional resources, and we're also ensuring that we have police coverage throughout the remainder of the city so that the citizens of Baltimore still have police services.
It's been about a half an hour at least, Captain Kowalczyk, since that CVS came under attack. Looters going in, they're stealing stuff, they're taking it out. And these are live pictures we're seeing from that CVS pharmacy over there. Look what's going, I don't know if you can see our CNN coverage right now, but they're just running in there and they're stealing stuff. Where are the police?
Yeah, I'm not in a position to be able to see your coverage right now. What I can tell you is that our first priority is the protection of life. And that includes the life of our officers and the life of the people that are in that community. So we're going to do what we can to make sure that our officers are safe, that residents in that area are safe, and as soon as we're able to ensure everyone's safety, then we'll move in and do what we need to do to protect property as well. But again, this is about having a reverence for life and making sure that we protect the lives of our officers and the citizens who live in that area.
You need reinforcements, Captain. You need the National Guard. You need police from neighboring communities from Washington, D.C. to come in and help?
You know, we've been very fortunate. We reached out several days ago to our law enforcement partners in the area and asked for assistance. That's something that we do for a lot of other large-scale events as well. It's routine for the police department to work with our surrounding partners. We've done that in this situation here as well. We're very thankful for their assistance, and we're going to continue to ask them for their assistance.
And what about the tear gas? You said you're using that because clearly if you go into this one area, and we're showing live pictures of the looters going in and out of that CVS pharmacy, if you go in there with a show of force with some armored vehicles or whatever, presumably they're all going to run away, right?
You know, again, it's about ensuring the safety of people first. I don't want to speculate about what tactics could and might work. What we know is that we have an obligation to protect lives. We're going to take appropriate measures and steps to ensure that we're protecting our officers. We had seven officers earlier that were injured pretty seriously. We've had broken bones. We've had large bricks thrown at us. So we're going to make sure that our officers are safe. We're going to make sure that the people that live in that community are safe. And that's got to be our first priority.
Just give us a little perspective on how big of an area is under attack right now, Captain. Is it just a few blocks? Is it a bigger area? How close is it, for example, to downtown Baltimore? How close is it to Johns Hopkins University?
Yeah, I don't know that I want to use the word attack, Wolf. I think what we're seeing here is a group of people that have no regard for other people's safety or the laws in the city. It's a fairly decent-sized area of the city. It's several blocks that we have our officers deployed into. We're shifting resources to make sure that those officers are supported. And again, our primary mission here is ensuring the safety of our officers and then the people that are in that area to make sure that no one else is injured.
And we're talking about injured. How many police officers have been injured?
We had seven officers that were seriously injured. I can tell you that that's incredibly frustrating for us. We saw on Saturday largely peaceful demonstrations, and that's what Baltimore is. I believe I heard while I was waiting to come on someone saying that there was a human wall of Baltimoreans that was being formed to stop the violence. That's what our city is. We have had a long history of peaceful protests. This level of violence is outrageous. The attacks on our police officers, the unprovoked attacks on our police officers is simply unacceptable. And we're going to continue to shift and move resources to make sure that we protect our officers and the people in that community. And I just can't emphasize that point enough. Our highest priority here is going to be the preservation and protection of life.
Are you going to go ahead and keep that Baltimore Orioles Major League Baseball game on tonight, 7:05 p.m. Eastern?
You know, I haven't been a part of that decision. This is a fast-moving, dynamic situation. There's a lot of information coming in that's being processed, and I've been talking to reporters. We want to get the message out. about protecting people's safety and the steps that we're doing to take a look at that. And we can't emphasize enough how important it is for us that our officers are safe and the people that reside in that area that are traveling through that area remain safe as well.
How many police vehicles have been destroyed? We saw several burnt and trash literally stoned with bricks or whatever.
Yeah, unfortunately, I don't have the count for you. Again, this is a pretty dynamic situation that's unfolding. And right now, the concern for us is taking care of our injured officers and deploying resources into that community so that we can protect the people that live there.
And photo, we know at least one photojournalist has been severely injured and is in a local hospital right now. Have other civilians, other members of the news media been injured as far as you know?
I'm walking into a briefing shortly to get more information on the situation. We're going to continue to try to put information out as quickly and frequently as we can. Our social media site, Twitter, we're using to live stream. So if people go to at Baltimore Police, we're trying to put out information there every 2 to 3 minutes so that people can get as frequent information and as up-to-date information as we're able to put out. And that's really the best way that we can keep people apprised. And we'll continue to do briefings throughout the night. We want people to know what's happening in the city as well.
And I assume you're going to want to arrest these rioters, the ones who have committed these crimes, right?
Absolutely. You know, we put out this morning, we did a media release. There's a pretty infamous photo right now of a gentleman wearing a blue hoodie standing on top of one of our cars. He was arrested this morning. We will conduct appropriate investigations and take people that are responsible for either physical attacks on individuals, on our officers, or any other crimes that we're able to investigate. We will take them into custody.
And you have a lot of closed-circuit cameras there, and you have a lot of cameras from overhead, so presumably you'll have some evidence to go after these individuals. Captain Kowalczyk, if you don't mind, I know you got to get to that meeting. If you could join us in a little while afterwards, we'd like to resume this interview and get the latest information for our viewers here in the United States and around the world.
Sir, I'll be happy to call in just as soon as I can.
All right, thank you very much. Eric Kowalczyk's the captain, the spokesman for the Baltimore Police Department. And once again, these are live pictures coming in from the streets of Baltimore. It's hard to believe this is going on in a major American city right now. This has been well advertised that some of these rioters, these demonstrators were going to get violent, but clearly the police wanted to play it down to begin with, didn't want to exacerbate the situation, but now it's gotten extremely, extremely ugly. Tom Fuentes, you've wanted to make a point as well.
Yeah, I can't believe the statement that when it comes to protecting property and people, it's suddenly an either-or proposition. It's a proposition you protect both. They knew this was going to be a bad day. The day of the funeral is always an emotional day anyway. They've had intelligence throughout the morning and early afternoon about the gangs threatening to attack the police. It's both. You have to protect the whole community, property, and people, and not decide one against the other.
Hold on
one second. This is active looting going on right now. You see them now dispersing. Maybe the police are getting closer, but you see they've been, I assume that CVS pharmacy is basically trashed by now, because for the last 45 minutes or so, they've been running in and out, and it's hard to believe this is going on, as I keep saying, in a major American city right now. Jeffrey Toobin is with us as well. He's our senior legal analyst. Jeffrey, you've covered crime in Baltimore, especially this one group called the Black Guerrilla Family that police say are involved in these protests. What do you know about this group?
Well, the Black Guerrilla Family is a longstanding prison gang, actually started in California, but they took over the Boston City Correctional Center, the BCDC, which is the local jail, and ran it for a period of about a year. Many of the guards and many of the prisoners have since been arrested, but it's indicative of a very serious gang problem that's been in Baltimore for quite some time. The Crips and the Bloods are also active, but the Black Guerrilla Family is the group that ran the jail. If I can just emphasize something that Tom said, you know, the idea that Officer Kowalczyk would say that the Baltimore police are doing their job by simply disappearing when stores are being looted, that is not my idea or my understanding of how the police are supposed to work. And no one there is a demonstrator. No one there is a protester. These are criminals. These are looters. And I think that distinction is not just semantics. These are criminals who are preying on this city, and the police should be out there doing something about it.
Yeah, I know that Pamela Brown is with us as well, our justice correspondent. The federal government, what, if anything, are they doing to prevent this city from at least several city blocks being trashed?
Well, we have a brand new attorney general just sworn in today, Wolf, Loretta Lynch, and we have learned that she has been called to the White House for a meeting with the president, and that the situation unfolding right now in Baltimore will be part of that discussion. I've been told that she has been monitoring the situation there. This is really her first major challenge since being sworn in as the attorney general, as the nation's top law enforcement officer just hours ago. The White House, DOJ, in close coordination right now. I can tell you with Ferguson, you know, Loretta Lynch's predecessor, Eric Holder, actually went to Ferguson, as you know, Wolf, on the ground there to calm the situation. He told me he believed that his presence there actually helped calm the mayhem. It will be interesting to see what Loretta Lynch does in this.